We are so thankful that today we've had such a great day. You know, one of the things that we use in warfare is praise. And if people would learn to praise God and thank Him instead of griping and mumbling and complaining, they could put the devil at rest real quick. But nobody wants to praise. What's the matter? What's the matter? I'm not understanding that. Am I muted?
No, I was.
She is.
As you're talking, I'm doing sound effects and visual effects. The devil was hiding, so I'm like,
very good. Well, then you should have been here for the first joke that I told. Did you hear it?
No.
The devil was arrested. He was charged with possession
of a controlled substance.
Yeah, the body. But anyway, getting back to praise, that is a real good tool in spiritual warfare. We're always talking about putting on the whole armor of God. Well, you need to learn to praise, because that puts the devil at bay, because God inhabits the praises of His people. So tonight, we praise You, Father. We thank You for everything that You have done for us today. We thank You, Lord, for this session tonight. We ask, Lord, that nothing be done or said that is not pleasing to You. We ask the Holy Spirit of God to watch over our mouths, to give us only the words of wisdom. And I thank You, Father, that everybody will participate tonight and that You will get all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. I have got to learn these sign languages because I think I'm doing something wrong. Or there's something showing.
If something is, I'll stop you like last time and make a booty out of myself.
Oh, I don't think you ever make a booty out of yourself. I like you just like you are, honey. I like you just like you are. So, did you know that scientists have just discovered that there is a food that stops a sex drive? You know what it is? Wedding cake.
That's right.
That's right.
I know I should have brought that.
I'm so glad that you said that. Because I was trying to explain to somebody the other day that drug that helps men. And I kept saying, you know that drug that makes your pee-pee go up? And I could not think of it. And just now, whenever you said whatever you said, made me think Viagra. And I'm like, now I'm texting the person. I just remembered it's Viagra.
We can quit calling. You know, now you know what takes it away, and that is wedding cake. Oh, we are just, God's got to help us tonight. We're in the book of Daniel because we're in Revelation, really. But before we go to 4, which there is an open door, we need to go back and get a little bit of context. And if you want to know what the revelation is for the book of Revelation in the Old Testament, it's Daniel. And Daniel, if you know, he was one of the young men that was taken captive when he was a teenager. But he loved God so much. And it said in the 3rd year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, into Jerusalem, and he besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, which part of the vessels of the house of God, which he came into the land of Shinar of the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, and he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seeds and of the princes. And he had, I wanted everybody to read, you know, chapters 1 and 2. And then we'll go into the other ones later. But these young men that was brought in as young teenagers, they were made eunuchs into the work, the service of the king. And Daniel, he was one that loved God so much that he did not want to defile himself in any way. And he talked to he found favor with people everywhere he went because God put favor on him. And you know, we're supposed to walk around with favor on us. The blessing should be on us. Favor should be on us. And they were children in whom no blemish. They were well-favored. They were skillful in all wisdom. cunning and knowledge, understanding, science, such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them daily food. He appointed them all kinds of delicacies that people love to go and pay lots of money at these restaurants to eat. Daniel said, nope, I don't want to eat it. And he talked to the head eunuch guy that took care of him. And he said, would you just let me eat what I want to eat? And he said, no, because if you don't survive and you don't flourish, the king will have my head. He said, well, give me 2 weeks, just 2 weeks. He gave him 2 weeks. And he ate just the food that God put in his heart. And he flourished better than any of the other young men there. Daniel found favor everywhere he went. And so we go on a read, and it says, he said he was going to prove him 10 days. And then, and as for these four other children, his friends, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they also served God like Daniel. Maybe not as heartily, because Daniel made himself outshining of all of them. They all had favor on them and wisdom. They all served God, and they all were going to give God the glory with their life of whatever they did. And the king had them in certain places within his palace, and they worked for him. And they did a very good job. Well, then the king one night had a dream. We're going to talk about that dream, because that dream was not for him then. It was for us now. And it had been shut up for almost 2,000 years. But now it's been revealed in the book of Revelation. So we're going to start in chapter 2, because he had a dream. And the king was so upset because nobody could tell him what the dream was about. And he said, if somebody don't tell me, and the other magicians, they said, well, if you'll tell us what you dreamed, we'll give you the interpretation. He said, nope, y'all tricked me before. You're not going to trick me this time. You're going to tell me the dream and the interpretation. Then I will know you're telling me the truth. And he said, if anybody doesn't do it, we're going to do some killing around here. Well, it got back to Daniel. And Daniel said, oh boy, we got to do something about this. So he prayed to God. And so he went, and of course we'll find this out. He went before the king to give me just a chance. Give me a chance. And let's see what happens. Okay, in chapter 2. Who would like to start reading that? Because I think everybody needs to read a little part so we can have everybody's participation. Anybody got their La Biblia open?
Revelation chapter 2.
Hello, Luke. Miss Luke, Miss Klutz, Miss Luke. Hello, you're muted. So I'm going to start, and then someone's going to pick up after me, because I'm not going to be the only one to read. It's a Bible study, and we will stop and discuss some of these verses. And in
Revelation
the second,
chapter 2?
No, we're in Daniel. Remember, we're in Daniel. Daniel is the Old Testament Revelation, and we're going to talk about it so that we can understand the book of Revelation when we go to chapter 4, because there is broken up into three parts, the book of Revelation is, and we know how it was. We talked about that, and we'll recover that again tonight, recap it, but I want us to go ahead and read into 2, and I will start it, and then when I stop, somebody pick it up. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled and his sleep broke from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and all the Chaldeans for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king, and the king said unto them, I've dreamed a dream, Martin Luther King, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syria, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we'll show you that interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me, If you will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, you shall be cut into pieces, and you shall, and your house, and will be made into a total dunghill. You will be decimated, all of you. So they had a pretty good threat over their head. Somebody pick it up at 6.
But if they shew the dream and the interpretation thereof, ye shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, shew me the dream and the interpretation thereof. They answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will shew the interpretation of it. The king answered and said, I know of certainty that ye would gain the time, because ye see the thing is gone from me. But if ye will not make known unto me the dream, there is that but one decree for you. For ye have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me, till the time be changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that ye can shew me the interpretation thereof. The Chaldeans answered before this king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can shew the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, Lord, nor ruler, that asks such things as any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. And it is a rare thing that the king requireth, and there is none other that can shew it before the king, except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. For this cause the king was angry and very furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said, Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to David.
Okay. Then David went. Right there, see, when he made that thing known to him, he realized they were in dire straits. If he didn't do something, they were all going to be killed, right along with all the other little liars. Daniel knew they were liars and charlatans and like that. We have a lot of false prophets on TV declaring all these things, and so many people are falling for it. If you don't have the spirit of wisdom and knowledge upon your life, you're going to have a problem, because you're going to believe that deception. And Jesus said, do not be deceived. That's the number one warning he gave us for the last days, because deception was going to be so prevalent in the ages. And the same way was going on here. And the dream that he had was given to him, but it was for us in the day and time that we're living. And we'll find that out when he's told not to say certain things. But Daniel wanted to save all of them alive. So if somebody will pick up now.
Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time, and that he would shew the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah and Mishael and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of the God heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings, and he setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise, and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the depth and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth within him. I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who hast given me wisdom and might, and hast made known unto me now what we desire of thee. For thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter.
All right, therefore, stop right there. Did you hear where he said, I thank thee and praise thee, O God? Didn't I just say at the beginning of this how praise is part of spiritual warfare? It puts the devil in his place. And God comes on the scene. And when you partner with God, God is obligated to help you. But we don't partner with God. We may speak at God and we may tell him what we want, but we don't pray according to his will and praise him for the answer. Even if you don't see the answer yet, you praise him. You thank him for it because it's coming. If you partner with God, God said, my word will not return to me void. In other words, it will be sent unto the earth to find a place where it will come forth. And that's what it was going to do with Daniel. He was going to be able to have this given to him and shown. And he was going to be able to save not only him and his three friends, but all the other men as well. And you would think they'd be thankful to him for doing that, but they hated him even more. They're so ding-a-lings. If you want, that's all I can come up with, a good nice word without saying something ugly. Because people are just ding-a-lings. You try to help them and they just want to just curse at you. So, who would like to pick it up now? Are the men the only ones?
I have one left up here, but I don't want to read. So, Kaylee, Jimmy.
Kaylee, you're a good reader. Brenda.
Hey, Kaylee.
Some of you ladies, you're muted and I can't hear you. But I know you can hear me, but Brenda. Feel like reading, Shay, Miss Luke?
I'm a little bit congested, but what chapter are we on?
We're in Daniel 2.
We're in Daniel.
And you stopped
24.
At
24.
Okay, I'm not there. I'm in Revelation.
Okay, remember we're doing Daniel, which is the Old Testament version of Revelation.
Okay.
So we're in chapter 2, and he stopped at chapter 2 in Daniel. And if you start,
if someone wants to read, I'll read the next while I find it.
Brenda, Brenda's working. She can't read. So I'm sorry, Brenda. Apple, you got it?
What? The chapter?
Yes. Chapter 2 and verse 24.
Sorry, I was reading on a different translation, so this might be a little different. Thereupon, Daniel went to Arioch, the king of what had appointed to kill the wise men of Babylon. He went and said this to him, do not kill the wise men of Babylon. Take me into the king's presence, and I will declare the interpretation to the king. Then Arioch hurriedly brought Daniel into the king's presence and spoke to him as follows. I have found a man among the exiles from Judah who can make the interpretation known to the king. The king said to Daniel, whose name is Belshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? Daniel answered before the king and said, as for the secret about which the king had inquired, neither wise men, sorcerers, soothsayers, sinners, priests, nor diviners are able to declare it to the king. However, there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets and has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will take place in the latter days. This was your dream and the visions in your mind while on your bed. As for you,
stop right there. Right there, he said, there is a God in heaven. A God in heaven that knows everything. He knows the secret parts. He knows secrets of everything. There is a God in heaven. And then you see where he said, he revealeth the secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. This, like I said, is talking about what's happened to us. It was given to Nebuchadnezzar. It wasn't for his day and time, but it was for us. That's why we had to stop after the churches so we could read this before we went into 4. when we go to an open door there in heaven. So he said that this was for the latter days, the dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed, and these are those. So are you ready, Shay, for 29, or Kaylee, whoever is going to read 29? Hello? Anybody feel like reading Daniel 2:29?
As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed, and what should come to pass hereafter, and he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sakes that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart. Thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, but no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of man dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven hath he given into thy hand, and hath made thee ruler.
All right, right there. If he had been alive today and God gave that to him, then he would own everything that you see, every part of the world. But the only known part that was known then, God gave to him to rule, to have Nebuchadnezzar. That's pretty awesome to have that kind of power. He was just a mere mortal man, and God gave that power to him. He could not have had it on his own, but he gets puffed up a little bit later on, and he thinks that he did it by himself. But it wasn't. It was the favor of God. You need to walk with favor on your life every day. Every one of you, you need to go walk around saying, I've got the favor. I got favor. Everywhere I go, I got favor. Men are supposed to give to you good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Men are to give to you. Today, we were blessed. We got something so that I could give out to people on these cold, hot days. And this gentleman brought it to us, and he was a wonderful man. And he told me, he said, you know what I'm going to do for y'all? I'm going to give you some tickets to the Ranger Games, the 23rd, and I'll give you as many as you want, and you can give them to whoever you want. That's a blessing. That's favor on your life. I've got favor. Wherever I go, I've got favor, and nobody can tell me I don't. And I don't say that to make people jealous. I don't say it for any reason other than to give God the glory. God gets all the glory. You should have favor. A reason a lot of people don't have favor on their life is they don't confess it. You must believe this word of God and confess it. You will decree a thing and it shall come to pass. But people will think they're decreeing it by saying it. No, that's not decreeing it. You've got to really believe it and decree a thing. And I decree I've got favor on my life. Everywhere I go, I am blessed. Men want to give to me. This sounds kind of hokey, and I'm real sorry about saying this, but even on some of the pages of Facebook and different places, I get marriage proposals all the time. I'm old enough to be their great granny, and I get marriage proposals, and I'm glad my husband's not a jealous type of man, but it's like, you know, I have favor on my life. You are no different than me, and you should have favor on your life. Every one of you should have results. You've got to have results on your life. God said we would be known by our fruits. We got to have fruit. Be known by your results. Have results. If you pray for something, have a result. Get before God in your secret prayer closet. Don't let go of the horns of the altar till you get what you need in the spirit, and then come out and decree it. And then when you do that, shut up. Shut up. Don't pick it back up. Shut up. I don't mean to be so angry, but I get angry in the spirit sometimes because I try to tell people how to make their lives work and they won't listen. They say they do, but they don't. Because if they did, they'd begin to change. And I know you walk little by little and we go by baby, like we had to all have baby food and all had to drink milk. Same way in the Bible. We're all at different levels. I just want people to be blessed. I don't like seeing people without jobs. I don't like seeing people without money. I don't like seeing people hurting. I want them blessed. And that's what Father wants. I've gotten the Father's heart. He wants people blessed. He said you'd have the poor with you always. And I think he wants us to do something about it. Do you know that's been one of the hang-up of the church? Is the prosperity message has been misused and mishandled. And people now are afraid to give. They're afraid to do anything about prosperity. But it takes money to spread the gospel. It takes money to help people. It takes money. And if that offends somebody, I'm sorry. You got to have money. And I want all of you guys to be so blessed that you're all millionaires by the end of this year. Wouldn't you like to be a millionaire before the end of this year?
Yes, ma'am.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you can help people. You want to be the head and not the tail. I'm not going to be the tail. I'm going to be the head because Jesus said I could be the head, and I'm going to be it. I've got the blessing of Abraham on me, and so do you if you're a child of God. And you need to believe it, decree it, and declare it. I'm telling you, you've got to have results. You've got to have results on your life, and I want to see that so desperately in the church. I want to see our church flourish bigger and better than any church around. He said, despise not thy small beginnings. And you know, when you begin to get blessed with the favor of God, people are going to try to be mean to you and they're going to try to knock you down. These guys here, Daniel is going to save them because of what God is using him. And they're going to get so mad at him, they're not going to want Daniel to prosper. They're going to do everything they can to trap that man and destroy him. And he only had good in mind when he went before God to get the answer. And that's what God wants us to do, is to have everybody's heart, to have them to be blessed. You don't want to be mean to people and curse them and hope they die, hope they're broke and poor. No, no. Even if you get your feelings hurt or whatever, forgive that situation and say, God, I want my heart right in this matter. I want to be a blessing to you and to others. Because you're a blessing to God when you bless other people. Did you know that?
Well, I'll be honest with you. That story that Charlie told about that Whataburger incident, I thought was brilliant.
The which one?
The Whataburger incident where he paid for the order, then drove off with the order. Brilliant.
Well, all right. One part was brilliant. The other part, I didn't like. You know that very well. I don't like playing cruel jokes on people at all. Not even for fun. But that's my nature. I can't help it. I would have paid for every car behind them and them and them and them if I could have. In my luck, did have bought stuff for the whole football team. I don't know. I want some smile on them faces, Gary. Come on, let's get blessed by God. The word of God is to give us joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And some of you get tired. I know you worked hard today. You've been through a lot of things, but you know, so have I. But when I start talking about God, that's when I get like a shot of adrenaline. Boy, do I get it. Okay, who's going to read now? Gary, you may have to go on because of some of these
others. I'll read.
Okay, good.
Let's see. He has given them into your hand and has made you ruler over them all. You are this head of gold, but after you shall arise another kingdom inferior to yours, then another, a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth, and the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything, and like iron that crushes, that kingdom will break in pieces and crush all the others. Whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, yet the strength of the iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed in ceramic clay. And as the toes of the feet were clay, and as the toes of the feet were partly of iron and partly of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly fragile. As you saw iron mixed with the ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume of all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces, and iron and bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king that will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its Okay, my eyes are not good. Are we in Daniel and his friends promoted?
We're yet 30?
46.
46?
Yes.
Yeah. Wow, I got way behind. So sorry. Okay, keep going then.
Okay, then King, I'm not going to be able to pronounce that one.
Nebuchadnezzar.
Okay, there you go, Gary. Fell on his face, prostrate before Daniel, and commanded that they should present an offering and incense to him. The king answered Daniel and said, "Truly, your God is the God of gods, the Lord of kings, and a revealer of secrets, since you could reveal this secret." Then the king promoted Daniel and gave him many great gifts, and he made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief administrator over all the wise men of Babylon. Also, Daniel petitioned the king, and he, Shadrach, Meshach.
He requested of the king that he said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Over the affairs of the province of Babylon, but Daniel sat in the gate of the king.
See, that made the other dudes really mad because he was being promoted. He had the favor of God upon him. Nebuchadnezzar was granted authority by God to rule the earth. And it symbolized he was the head of gold. He was the gold. And the first kingdom represented the head of gold, which is Babylon, with Nebuchadnezzar as its ruler. So you've got to understand about this. We used to call him the millennial man when I was teaching my little girls when they had Bible school at our home school. And the second kingdom symbolized by silver would arise after Babylon, being an inferior one, understanding that how that was all going to take place, because Jerusalem had been taken and decimated twice. One time it wasn't as bad. The second time it was even worse. And Nebuchadnezzar's authority and rulership was granted by God. You don't get authority and power unless God gives it to you, or you go and steal it. But if you steal it, you're not going to keep it very long. I'll tell you that right now. Because God is taking names and numbers, and he's going to pay back those that have taken things that was not supposed to be theirs. Now, I could talk about the election, but I won't go into that. because God sets one up and he puts one down. And sometimes he puts someone up that's an evil person because we need to be put back in our place. Where did he say judgment was going to begin? At the house of God.
In the church.
The house of God. And of course, obviously we are the church now, but he is talking about the church collectively. He is going to have judgment at begin there. And we've got to understand that we're in the age of Gentiles still right now. And one of these days, the time of the Gentiles is going to be fulfilled and it's going to be through. And each of these kingdoms must be a Gentile kingdom during this age. And secondly, each kingdom must be more powerful kingdom on earth in its day, which replaces the one that was before it. And thirdly, each kingdom must defeat its predecessor. And finally, it must assume control over Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Jesus wept over Jerusalem. Do you remember what he did? He went up there on a mountain and he looked down over Jerusalem and he wept. And he said, oh, Jerusalem, how you missed the day of your visitation. And he wept. He cried over Jerusalem. We should be crying over Jerusalem right now, what they're going through. I'm not necessarily talking about the Jews. That's God's people. But I'm a spiritual Jew because I accepted Jesus. So that makes me a spiritual Jew. And I am very proud to be that because I'm a child of God. But the thing is, he said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. He didn't say pray for the peace of the Jews. He said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we need to be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. So this, I tried to get a copy of that put over here on here where you could see what that millennial man looked like. And the great stone that's cut without hands. That's Jesus. That's coming down. That's going to tear those kingdoms up because Jesus has been given a kingdom that is eternal and that will never, ever pass away. That is what will happen in the last days. And we're seeing that happen right now. And we needed to see that here when he talked about him, he said, then there will be a fourth kingdom as strong as iron, in so much as iron crushes and shatters all things. So like iron that breaks in pieces, it will crush and break all these in pieces. And in that you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, it will be divided kingdoms. But it will have in the toughness of iron, in so much as you saw the iron mixed with common clay. And the toes of the feet were partly of iron and partly of pottery. So some of the kingdom will be strong and part of it will be brittle. And in that you saw the iron mixed with common clay, they will combine with one another in the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, even as iron does not adhere to pottery. The final kingdom features the least valuable and most brittle material and is reflected in the tendency to crush and break into pieces. The fourth kingdom, as depicted in the statue, replaces the previous one by breaking and crushing into pieces. Each one does that every time they crush it. Like the Roman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, what happened to it? Then the fourth kingdom, and then it kept going on and on. And you can see over 2,000 years, this alliance has continued to dispossess Israel and keep Jerusalem under Gentile authority. Right now, you're seeing it. Right now, the Gentiles. Anybody that's not a Jew is a Gentile. Doesn't matter if they're Arab or who they are Gentile if they are not Jewish. But the fourth kingdom reaches its end, and the kingdom experiences a division into 10 parts represented by the 10 toes. And that's where you're going to talk about in Revelation about the 10 kingdoms that's going to rise up out of the sea and all these things. And to understand that, we needed to look here in Daniel because Nebuchadnezzar had that dream, and Daniel was able to interpret it. But he's going to be told to shut it up, because it wasn't to be foretold or shown until the church age. Why? Because they weren't ready for it. God was waiting for the end of the age. And we've been in the end of the age since the church age began. But the thing is, we are at the end of the end of the end. Have you flushed your commode today? Anybody flush their commode and watch it?
Yes.
Yes.
The water goes like this. And then right when it's getting down the bottom, it goes, shh. That's the way life is right now.
The Coriolis effect.
Like this. That's right. Now, shh. because we are the end of the end of the end of the ages. And Daniel said, in those days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed. Now let's understand how this age ends by understanding how this statue comes to an end. Daniel doesn't explain about the 10 toes represented here, but we will find out about that in Revelation. But he said in Daniel 2:44, in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed, and the kingdom will not be left for another people. It will crush and put an end to all these kingdoms, but it will itself will endure forever. Inasmuch as you saw that a stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, a stone cut without hands, if you remember when we talked about altars, it's been several months ago, weeks ago, we talked about altars. They were always cut without hands. That's very hard to do because God wanted things cut without weapons or iron or whatever. Inasmuch as you saw that a stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it crushed the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will take place in the future. So the dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy. You can be rest assured that Jesus Christ will be coming back to set things in order. And there will be a millennium age that we will get to help rule and reign. And if we can't get along with each other in the church and judge things between ourselves, what's going to happen when we judge the nations? We can't. If you tell lies all the time, how are you going to judge the nations? Hmm?
If you're gonna lie about it and pretend it didn't happen.
Well, that ain't going to work. I'm just sorry. I know you're going to say, I'm innocent, I'm innocent, I'm innocent.
deny, then count our keys.
But Deuteronomy 27:5 says, moreover, you shall build there an altar to the Lord your God, an altar of stones. You shall not wield an iron tool on them. That's what I just talked about a while ago. We had talked about altars, where they put altars to place. What is an altar for? What's an altar for?
Sacrifice.
It's also a place where you have an exchange with God. That is a place you go before him to present yourself a living sacrifice, and you have a divine exchange with God there. If you remember, Jacob laid there, and it was an altar. He did not even know that that was a house of God, that God was in that place until the next time he came, and then he gave it the name. But you see, sometimes God visits us, and we don't even realize he's visiting us. He may visit you through a circumstance, a person, or whatever, and you're not in tune with what the Spirit is saying. What gives God more joy than anything is for you to walk with him. Do you know what he liked to do with Adam? He went and walked with him in the cool of the day. He loved to walk with him, to walk and talk with him. He wants you to walk and to talk with him and tell him how much you love him. And the writers here tells us, and we could have gone into Hebrews and a lot of other, Jeremiah brought up, I could just send you all the scriptures if you want, about the events. But now, where do we go next? From where do we add more pieces to this puzzle for the age to proceed and things after this? We will look when we go into Daniel, I think we said 2:7-9, wasn't it?
Yes.
Because Jesus is the one that is the one cut without hands. He was not brought here on earth by the help of a man. He was brought here by the Holy Spirit of God. It took a woman to incubate and to carry him and to have a vehicle for him, but no man gave birth to him. He had God's blood. I see your pretty baby cow. Everybody, that's Harriet. See that little cat? She was born in a pond of water. And if Tammy hadn't seen her when she did, the little calf would have drowned. And then the mama refused it. So she's bottle fed. But isn't she a doll? God has so many wonderful things. And it's so wonderful that we do our part to help God with these things. Well, we're going to get ready to do some quizzes. I want to know what y'all think about what we read in Daniel about the dream that he had. And then we will be moving, not next week, but the following, we'll go back to Revelation 4, the open door. Yeah. I love the open door. Anybody got anything to say about Daniel? Brother Daniel, you were Belshazzar. Oh, Brother Daniel. Oh, come on.
I'll have to go back and read. I got on kind of late, so I'll have to go back and kind of read through. And then I'll have something to say.
So that rock that was, we know that that's Jesus, but could there be a physical rock also that strikes the nations physically, not just, yeah, it's Jesus, yes, just Jesus, because I was thinking of that asteroid that's coming in 2029 called Apophis. Could it be an actual rock and also representative of Jesus?
Absolutely, because it doesn't just have one meaning, but the main primary meaning is about Jesus coming to set up the kingdom. He's going to destroy the earthly kingdoms, but he uses other things to destroy. Now, doesn't he? Didn't he use Pharaoh when he sent Moses? Did y'all know that the reason why that Nineveh repented in sackcloth so quickly when Jonah finally went, Jonah knew they would ask God to forgive him, and he didn't want them to be forgiven. He hated them, and he did not want them forgiven. Now, see, he had a bad spirit, and he took the first submarine ride on a fish, and the fish got a bellyache and said, "You're so bad, I'm going to throw you up." Threw him up right there at Nineveh's city limits. They were so evil, they would have skulls on sticks to let people know, don't come to our city because we're not going to welcome you. Do you know why they were so ready to repent with sackcloth and dust, even to the animals? Over here, he wasn't that great of a preacher. He didn't even have it in his heart to do it. But he was doing it because God said, yeah, you will do it, or else you're not going to be around, buddy. So he chose to do what God wanted him to do. And when he did, that's when the big fish got a bellyache. But why did Pharaoh so quickly, that king there, why did he so quickly have the people to repent? Why? Come on, somebody give me that answer. Well, I'll tell you why. Because Pharaoh was not drowned in the Red Sea. His army and everybody was. So Pharaoh, when he left Egypt and he went there to Nineveh, and he became the ruler there in Nineveh. He saw what the God of Israel did, the one true God. And he knew that if he didn't repent, what was going to happen to Nineveh? So he said, boys, gals, cows, everybody, we're going to repent in dust, and we're going to fast for 3 days. We're going to do what he said. Because he saw what God did. A lot of people don't know that because they're not taught a lot of things in church. They need to be taught some truth to go along with some context of what they're being taught, because then they can understand, why did this man so readily give his heart and stuff? He saw what God could do. He saw it. He saw those men drown. He saw all those dead bodies floating the next morning. So that's why he was so readily wanting to repent. And Jonah knew that he would repent. That's why he didn't want to go and tell them about God, because he knew it. He hated them, and he wanted them dead. So anyway, we're not going to get into that. That's another rabbit trail I like to go down. But that's why he repented so quickly. And I don't know what brought each and every one of you to Lord Jesus Christ, but I'm glad he did, because you're my brother and you're my sister. And I love the family of God, and I love this group of people. And there were several others supposed to be here tonight, but, you know, we have life going on and things come up. I had every intention of trying to go into Bible study last night. I couldn't make it. Just couldn't make it. But if I've got the intention of the pastor's heart, he's wanting each group to grow with new people and stuff to get it going. Like Shauna's not here tonight. Something must be wrong with her.
She hasn't responded to text today very much.
Yeah, so I don't know what's going on with Shauna. I know there were several other people that we need to check on, because our group should be really expanding, and it's going to. I decree and declare it's going to, because the glory of God will go to God. Nothing we do except present His word, and He will get the glory. I would love to see about 10 other men, Charlie, the captain, and Gary Golden. All right, Captain and Golden, they're faithful, and Jimmy Ray Luke, the third. They are three faithful men, and the pastor, I never get to see him, but he's here. I can see his picture. And those are faithful men. I love faithful men of God. I love faithful women of God. But I'd like to see it equal. I'd like to see about 10 more men and 10 more women, wouldn't y'all?
Yes.
We can do it. We can do it.
Yes.
We can do it. So I'm going to believe that that's going to happen. Well, we've...